and welcome to Out the Video, the award-winning, nationally recognized LGBTQIA+ TV news magazine. I'm Roberta Gonzalez-Gregg. Out the Video usually broadcasts from the Create TV studios in San Jose. However, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, are now brought to you via Zoom. We sincerely hope this finds you, your family, your loved ones, all safe and well. Today, we have the pleasure to bring to you Daryl Jones, documentary filmmaker, whose latest endeavor, Tender, features trans women of color in San Francisco's Tenderloin District, telling their stories of how they're living.
This is here in the city of San Francisco. And I moved outside of my grandmother's house when I was 25 years old.
When I moved here in 1997, there were quite a number of trans women.
I'm in a substance abuse treatment program.
SRO is an abbreviation for single room occupancy.
Welcome to Out the Video, Daryl.
Hi, thank you very much. I really appreciate it, Roberta.
You bet. It's good to have you here. Or should I say professor?
Oh, I'm an instructor at UC Santa Cruz. I haven't earned my PhD yet.
Okay. I wanted to address you appropriately and with respect. But I do have a great deal of respect. This documentary, telling the lives of people we wouldn't know otherwise, is really something that brings us out to the public. How did this come about?
Thank you for asking. And one thing I'd like to address first off, Roberta, in your question is talking about lives that we would not know about otherwise. And that is part of how this film came about. I wanted to express that there are other lives out there besides what we know or see outside of our own. I wanted to explore that. And I was fortunate enough to have a community of Black trans women who allowed me in to do a little bit of that. The story, or I should say how this came about, I can say it took a lot of reflection and a lot of time. When I first wanted to make a film, I wanted to make something that reflected how I felt inside about being bullied as a youth, being treated unfairly because of who I was, because I'm Black and because I'm gay. And as I explored it, I was looking for a community that I thought I could also help in a similar manner. If I am being treated this way, how can I help others? I will get back to why that was a poor way to go approach it. But I will say that along the way, as I was thinking about how best to help others, I came to realize that what I thought was important to Black trans women, HIV and AIDS, access to hormones, things like that. As I did my ethnography, I learned that those things are not on the top of there. Agenda.
Your film really hits on a note on their housing situation, and right. That seems to be something that was on the forefront of the minds of these three particular trans women. Am I correct in that?
Absolutely, Roberta. And yes, so as I got to know them better, into their community, was allowed to do volunteer work and just speak to them and hang out with them, you know. I learned that housing was one of many issues that are important to them. As the film developed, as I was editing it, and as I was talking to them further, that really became a central issue naturally and organically in the film. This is one of the things that four of the women actually, and many of the women outside of the film that I talked to expressed a very, very, very strong opinion about, and rightfully so.
It's yes, natural. Indeed, right, Rightfully so. You're correct, rightfully so. I mean, that means a great deal to all of us. If we have a roof over our heads, if we feel safe and secure where we're living, then we can go on to other things in our lives. And I'd like that you show that it's no different in the trans community.
It's a really just a human right, right? I believe.
Exactly.
It's quite simple. If we feel secure, if we have security, yes, we can then always move on to other things. Yes. Better things.
Indeed. Indeed. Well, you show it very well in the film. And of these three women, that you, when they first came up, the letters, and they talked about one woman in particular spoke about the SRO room where she's at. And me being acquainted with theater, I think of SRO as standing room only. But it's, you know, in a sense, it does show a very limited space, though it means single room occupancy. So it is a small space, but it's something that she was very proud of to call her own. And that really shows in your film.
Thank you. Her name's Ranjay, and very beautiful, charming woman. And yes, one of the things I absolutely do love about that scene is how much it means to her. And that sense of pride, that having your own key, that's for anybody who's getting a new home, getting a new apartment, getting their own space. It's really symbolic.
It is indeed, isn't it though? And there are two other women that, who are highlighted in the film, who also speak of home security meaning utmost in their minds. Then they're able to go on and do work within the community also. So that's something special, you know, that they also want to give back, you know, so that's really a nice highlight.
Yes. And you know, that's one of the main tenets, main models, one of the main core beliefs of Janetta Johnson and the women at TGIJP who were a part of the film. They believe in self advocacy. They believe in advocating for themselves first and from within and grassroots. They know that that sort of help has to come from within. And what they want from outside of the community, from people like you and me, is our attention, our time, and taking the time to understand that their security and their needs are our security and our needs. When we donate money, time, things of that nature to these organizations, when we shift policy, when we advocate for them in City Hall and across state local government, then we're actually helping them. Then we're actually supporting them in doing something. And it's not that hard, right? They're not asking for us to join their community and become something we're not. They're asking us to do something that we can do naturally.
I like that. Well, very well said, that something that we can do naturally. And these particular people in the film also speak so naturally of themselves, of their surroundings. It gives a lot of pride, and it shows a lot of pride, and you did a wonderful job in that. Getting to your particular subject of documentary filmmaking, you've been doing this for a while?
Well, it seems like for a while. this is my first film, and it was actually my MFA thesis film, but it's gotten a good reception. It's been well received, gotten into a few film festivals, and that's nice to have that recognition. What I like the most is that the festivals that are recognizing it are Black film festivals and trans film festivals. So it's really reaching the community that I want it to reach and being received by the community that I want to receive it.
Yes, another great source. Yes, indeed.
Thank you.
Yes.
And it is now being distributed through newday.com, and you can purchase it there or stream it there if you'd like. But what I'd also like to say about it is that it has all of this access for us And there's time when we were looking at this film to think about the politics involved and how we can help our communities. There are a lot of different ways that we can do that with housing advocacy, housing rights, and helping the unhoused in our community. I mean, it's gotten ridiculous, the number of unhoused. Yeah.
Especially here in the Bay Area.
You're right.
Yes, indeed, it is indeed. And we often, I know, speaking for myself, I'm often perplexed when I'm in the peninsula area, but when I travel around the Bay Area and see those people living in different, really difficult circumstances, I want to say, how can I help? What can I do to help? And your film sort of points us in a good direction as to what we can do, and also what we can do to help build community. So that's excellent. Thank you for that. Thank you very much for that. Do you have other films in the works?
I do. I'm working on a film right now called The New Roxy Theater, and it is about segregation in Clarkstown, Mississippi, and how my family dealt with segregation by going to the movies and working in the theater.
Okay.
So I'm really excited about that.
Yeah. Is that your hometown?
Clarkstown, Mississippi, it is, yes.
Yeah, all right. And have you been in the Bay Area?
Oh, well, I've lived here for 20 years now.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so you were just a baby when you left.
out of high school.
Well, good. We'll look forward to that film also.
Thank you.
Anything else you'd like to tell us about this film that we haven't touched? I think we've touched on quite a bit. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I want to say that this film was done as an effort to show unity, how we are all equal. Mm-hmm. And I did it in an effort to show how gay, lesbian, bi, trans communities are all the same. And as Black people, we are all the same. And I learned through this that is definitely not the case. My privilege as a cisgender man holds a lot of weight. My privilege as a college educated man holds a lot of weight. And I learned from Janetta Johnson, Cookie Bivens, Ron J. Evans, the women in this film, their issues, the things that are important to them, the things that make me different from them as Black trans women. Those are really, really strong and important differences that should be highlighted and praised. And we should all seek ways that we are greater and better together, and not how we're different.
Well said.
I really, really, really learned that. I enjoyed my time with them, and I had a
really well said. Greater and better together.
I appreciate it, Roberta. Thank you.
Oh, that's absolutely wonderful, Daryl. Thank you so much for spending your time with us today with Outlook Video, highlighting this film. We look forward to. You said we can catch it different ways. You told us earlier that it's also available on Canopy.
Yes, you can also find it on Canopy. Yes.
Okay. Oh, great. So our viewers can watch it in its full length. In different fashions. Yes. Thank you so very much again for your time, for putting this film together, for bringing some pride to our community. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All righty. Stay safe and well.
This is here in the city of San Francisco, and I moved outside of my grandmother's house when I was 25 years old.
When I moved here in 1997, there were quite a number of trans women.
I'm in a substance abuse treatment program.
SRO is an abbreviation for single room occupancy.
It's hard to find anything outside of an SRO in the Tenderloin.
Not something I want to get comfortable and say, girl, I've been here for 12 years.
It's time for us to really, really, really tap into our grassroots way of supporting transgender women, particularly around housing. It's brutal here in the city and county of San Francisco.
Zach Wallace, you're watching Outlook Video.
Video viewers, as you may be aware, Outlook Video is broadcast here in the Northern California Bay Area, but available online to viewers everywhere. I'd like to share with you information regarding programs for seniors, specifically here in the San Mateo County Bay Area. Peninsula Family Service offers many diverse programs in San Mateo, such as the Let's Talk weekly Zoom meetings. I am happy to announce that I shall be facilitating a Let's Talk Zoom group specifically for women of the LGBTQ plus community. Please view and respond to the information you'll see on your screens and join us for a weekly hour of conversation, community, and story sharing. I look forward to hearing from you as we become acquainted with this fun, relaxing program. Again, these programs are available only to seniors in the San Mateo County area, and we appreciate hearing from you. Thank you.
We love to get mail from you. Email us at comments@outlookvideo.org.
To contact us by phone, call 408-293-3040, extension 205.
Visit our website at outlookvideo.org.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/outlookvideo.
And connect with us at facebook.com/outlookvideo.
Stop the hate.
Enough is enough.
Stop the hate.
Stop the hate.
Enough is enough.
Stop the hate.
Enough is enough.
Stop the hate.
Stop the hate.
Yo, what are you doing?
Enough is enough.
Stop the hate.
Stop the hate.
Stop the hate.
Enough is enough.
Stop the hate.
Stop the hate.
Stop the hate.
This is not your home. We do not want you here.
You heard about the notion about the Kung Flu or the Wuhan virus. Members of our community being accused as Chinese spies when many of them aren't even Chinese. According to Stop AAPI Hate, an organization categorizing the increase in hate crimes, California alone has seen 43% increase in hate crimes towards the Asian Pacific Islander community. And as all of you know, in the Asian Pacific Islander culture, respect of our elders is a high value. And yet, we are seeing members of our community being harassed, murdered on everyday streets in the United States and here, yes, even in the state of California. A 91-year-old who was assaulted in Oakland, Chinatown. An 80-year-old in Pasadena, murdered just simply crossing the street. An 84-year-old of Thai descent was assaulted and subsequently died from his injuries. In fact, the Thai consulate has even issued a warning to Thais living in the United States and California to be aware of such hate crimes. Back in the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, which forbid Chinese coming to this country. Or the Alien Land Law in California in 1912, which forbid Asian Pacific Islanders from owning property. Or that of
a living civil rights icon, and Mike Conda, who survived and lived during the internment camps. In fact, here even at home, San Jose has its own dark history towards the Asian Pacific Islander community. Did you know we had 5 Chinatowns, many of them burnt down, sanctioned to be burnt down, which is why it is so meaningful to see our county and our city officials here in solidarity with our community. We have been victimized just last week in Mountain View, just this week in San Jose. Enough is enough. How much more will we tolerate? None. That's why we are here. There are those that wish us to be the model minority, to be silent, to stay in our own little box, not cause trouble. And our message collectively here today, with respect to being a model minority, is f*** no.
Yeah.
Women. Their communities lost parents, lost friends, lost co-workers, lost mothers. And I know we are here today to honor them, to remember them, and to make sure the violence that took their lives ends. And it is so important to remember that violence against Asian folks is not new. As long as white supremacy has existed, our people have lived through violence.
When we have to face in our society this level of violence and hate against our community members, the best way to respond and to fight back is by showing that much more solidarity, that much more community, that much more love and respect to one another. And that's what you are all doing here today, and that's what we need to do every single day going forward, because we are not going to let this next generation grow up in a world that's guided by hate, white supremacy, and violence. We're gonna make a world that we will all be proud to live in.
When one life continues to not matter, then none of them do. All lives cannot matter until Black lives do. All lives cannot matter until queer and trans lives do. All lives cannot matter until Asian lives do. When Asian lives are under attack, what do we do? When Black lives are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
When queer and trans lives are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
When our Asian elders are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
One last time, when Asian lives are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
Thank you.
Show up, donate to the victims' families, educate yourself.
and to the Asian women out there, for those who are feeling so much, of what's stirring up inside, or to those who aren't feeling at all because it's too painful to really, really let yourself feel during this time, I hear you, I feel you, I see you. And know that you are beautiful, you are worthy, and you deserve to be safe. And with an open, beating, and feeling heart, I just pray. Let's remember our common humanity, and let's remember why we're here together in solidarity. Thank you.
Because as we look out here and we see what's going on, it's been said over and over again, that if we're going to change things, if we're going to make things better, we've got to acknowledge that all vulnerable communities, all communities of color, all trans people, all queer people, everybody that is marginalized and at risk, we all have to form and get together and work together to create this change. When you go back to your homes, when you go back to the Castro, when you're out there and you see each other, communities of color, queer people, Asian people, oh, I didn't mention, or I forgot to mention, you know, the Pulse shooting as well, because that's also another thing that we all have to think about as communities of color. We are all at risk. And until we all start to come together and organize, get involved, get into politics, vote, speak up, talk to people, and make your voices heard. So, as the executive co-chair of the Castro Cultural District, I want you to know that we hear you. We see you. I feel your pain. I feel your sorrow. I fucking feel your anger. I'm going to tell you that right now. And we stand here with you.
I hope you take this moment as a point where we finally turn the tide and make the change happen. But it starts with you first. And I can't say that enough. I'm wearing this flag on my heart because I have to believe that America is something that we build together. Okay? We can't do it. We can't allow it to do it. It's not possible.